don't know me, my name is Jeff Patton. I'm here because I'm old and I've been in software development a long time. I'm partly here because I got a very early start with agile development. I started with a process called extreme programming in 2000, and I found out in 2001 that I was using an agile process, and XP was one, as well as Scrum and other things like this. But my first job title at that first XP project was product manager. So I come into this agile stuff from a product management perspective. But like most of you, I've been an engineer, and well, for a very long time, I worked at a company called Thoughtworks. If anybody's heard of that company before, a lot of continuous integration and continuous delivery stuff came from Thoughtworks, and I was a senior engineer there. Now, what I want to talk about, my focus these days is on product development. I work with companies. Every company is a product company. Every company makes a product that could be a software company. It could be software if you're a company like Atlassian, you make things like Jira. But if you're a bank, your products are checking accounts and credit cards. Those are your primary products, but we all need technology to support that stuff. I talk with organizations and help them adopt a product-centric posture. Look, I want to connect product development to DevOps. A long time ago, we had development and ops, and at least somebody connected those two things together. It's about time we connected the product stuff back. I want to explain to you how product people use good DevOps practice, because a lot of product people don't know how to use good DevOps practice, and on the flip side, a lot of DevOps people have no idea how product people are supposed to be using a good DevOps practice. So let's start from the beginning. First, this is a DevOps conference, so you all know what DevOps is. I used to work at a company called Thoughtworks. If anybody knows those two people, Jez and Dave, were co-workers of mine, and I've had the pleasure of working with them on several projects over the years. And look, in 2010, we got continuous delivery, and a lot of the foundational thinking we've got from DevOps came out of that. Now, in 2018, I see copies of Accelerate around here. Nicole Forsgren and Jez, and then Gene Kim, wrote the book Accelerate. And a lot of the work, or a lot of what's in that book, spun out of, it was Puppet that was doing the DevOps? State of DevOps report, that's correct. And Nicole, who was a PhD, added a lot of good thinking to this stuff. And spinning out of that state of DevOps report came the DORA metrics. Now, people familiar with DORA metrics, you know what those things are? DORA is short for the DevOps Research and Assessment Group. DORA metrics started as independent, but when I've known these guys, Google purchased DORA, so now it's DORA metrics DevOps Research and Assessment is owned by Google. And I should have had a slower build on this. I work with a lot of organizations who focus their DevOps and closely track those metrics, those throughput metrics, the cycle time. Now, I see different ways to measure cycle time, but it's usually the simplest, the time we integrate code or commit code until the time it's in production. Although I've heard guys like Martin Fowler say, the cycle time actually starts at the time we come up with an idea or put something into a backlog and the time it gets into production. Different ways to look at cycle time, but look, we want to be able to get ideas or stuff into code and that code out into production fast. So we want to reduce that cycle time. We want to see cycle times. Nicole will talk about cycle times for companies in less than a day. Less than a day from when I commit the code to when it arrives in production. And then deployment frequency. Look, I remember the bad old days when we might deploy or put something out every few months, then every month, then every few weeks. And now we've all heard numbers like Amazon is deploys new code into production every few seconds or even less these days. Everybody heard that? That's ideal. But we want to deploy frequently, but we want to have a lot of stability. So we look at change failure rate, look every, what's the rate that we fail when we put things out, and we look at mean time to recovery. From the time that a service goes down, how long does it take before we can restore service to customers? Does anybody work for an organization that's using those DORA metrics at all? Just a couple. I made a bad assumption that everybody knows what DORA metrics are. But look, these end up being gold standard. I work with a lot of organizations that are leaning hard on DORA metrics. And the reason we're doing that is because, in theory, it makes us, turns us into stronger companies. The reason Accelerate is doing well, look, I'm gonna let Nicole explain why we do this stuff.
Also, DevOps is good for organizations. So here's what we find. High performers, year over year, are twice as likely to achieve or exceed their commercial goals. Again, profitability, productivity, and market share. I like money. Any organizations, anyone here works for an organization that likes money, profit-driven? Right? So this speaks to us. But it's interesting, after a few years, some people came back to us and they said, I work for a not-for-profit, I work for government, I work for some educational institutions, or I work for a for-profit institution that has broader goals. We also care about other things. Other things matter to us. What about non-commercial goals, even if I'm in the for-profit sector? So in the 2017 study, we added additional measures like non-commercial goals. And the crazy thing is we find the same 2x multiplier. High-performing organizations are twice as likely to achieve or exceed non-commercial goals. Effectiveness, efficiency, customer satisfaction. By the way, the measures for these are drawn from the academic literature. Highly, highly rigorous measures. Okay, for bonus points, in the 2014 study, we had a large enough data set that I could actually pull from stock market data. And we find that high performers had a 50% higher market cap growth over the previous 3 years. So this is great, okay? The ability to develop and deliver software, technology, is driving organizational performance.
Nicole spoke here 2-3 years ago. When was that? Did anybody see her come and speak that's here in the room? Yeah. So I've met her and talked with her a few times. But I want to make sure you're all hearing what I'm hearing. And I should have pulled out one of her slides that explains who high performers are. And high performers are the people that really do great on all those DORA metrics. So I want to make sure you're hearing what I hear, that if we've got strong DevOps practice, something magic happens, and then our companies make more money. Is that what you're hearing? Look, if that's what you're hearing, I've seen this model before. I'm going to play you a short video, and I'm not going to give it much preamble, but this is a 20-year-old video, and some of you might have seen it before, but I use this to explain to people how product thinking works.
Anybody know anything about corporations?
I think my mom is a corporation.
Yeah, that makes sense.
You guys!
Well, how about we just say corporate should be stopped?
How do we stretch that into 5 minutes?
You're taking my underpants!
Will you stop with the underpants, Gnome Tweak? We have to work here!
What the hell?
Where I began.
That's my last pair of underpants!
Shh, don't scare him.
Hey there, little guy.
Bah!
Cartman!
Why?
Why do you always have to hit stuff with a stick?
Well, look at him. He's out, you know. Look at him.
Dude, why are you taking Tweak's underpants?
Yeah, look what you're doing to this poor kid.
Stealing underpants. Big business.
Business? Wait, do you know anything about business?
Sure, that's what gnomes do.
Show us.
Okay, follow me. Not much longer now. Follow me. This is where all our work is done.
So what are you gonna do with all these underpants that you steal?
Collecting underpants is just phase one. Phase one, collect underpants.
So what's phase two?
Hey, what's phase two? Phase one, we collect underpants.
Yeah, but what about phase two?
You see, phase one, collect underpants. Phase two, phase three, profit.
Oh, I get it. No, you don't. Do you guys know anything about corporations?
You bet we do. Us gnomes are geniuses at corporations.
Anybody seen that before? Good. I'm glad. When I hear Nicole talk, I'm hearing an underpants gnome scheme. Look, I know that good DevOps practices work. I've seen lots of companies where they work. But there's a missing step in here. There's a missing step that comes in between releasing fast and at high quality and profit. And that's what I want to talk about. Look, I want to look at this through a product lens. Now, I dropped another slide in here quickly, but look, I'm not the one looking at this through a product lens. The DevOps community is looking at this through a product lens. What was that clapping for? People have seen this project to product. Nick Kirsten is in Gene Kim's publishing company has released that book. And look, we know that this stuff connects to product, but I want you guys to know exactly how this connects. So let's look. I want to give you guys a basic boot camp in product thinking. Let's see how fast I can go here. Look, I want you to think about a product that you love. And I want one that you would recommend to other people. I want to ask you this question. What makes a product great? Can somebody shout out a couple things? Think of a product you love, one that you would recommend to other people. What makes it a great product?
Sensibility.
Did you say sensibility?
No, accessibility.
It's intuitive. I heard useful. I heard solves a problem. Oh, shoot, too many. Louder. What was that?
Sense of humor.
Sense of humor. Yeah, there are products that seem to embrace fun a little bit better. What else? Couple more.
Relatable.
That's relatable. I'm sorry, there's stuff in the back I'm missing. Relatable, it's customer centric. Say it again.
Easy.
Easy to use. Easy to use. God, I'm sorry. Easy to use. It's not easy to hear. Anything else? Yeah, it works. Yeah, that's always, it works, it's not down, things like that. I enjoy using it. I enjoy using it, makes life easier. Stable. Let's flip this question a little bit. If you work for a company that builds a successful product, and it's one of your greatest products at the company you work for, your company says, this is one of our great products, why are they saying that? What makes it great? It's probably some of those things, but what else?
Money.
Okay, yeah. ROI, revenue. Anything else?
Historical track record.
Historical track record, man. Repeat customers. That may be good enough. The first thing I want to point out is I ask this a lot of time. I ask this of people all the time. As many times as I've asked this, nobody says things like finished on time or stakeholders love it. It had more releases than any other product. None of those things make a product great. I need to draw a fundamental or foundational model that I start every class with, I start most talks with. If somebody's heard me talk before, you've seen me draw this before. But I might spin this, I'll try and spin this just a little bit differently. We work in companies that build products. We take ideas and we turn those into something we can ship. Now, those ideas could be for whole new products. But one of the things that we do, one of the things that makes DevOps relevant, is we build technology products. We build software products. The big difference between a software product and a traditional product is traditional products improve themselves using an obsolescence model. Look, if I got an awesome coffee machine and the manufacturer creates a new awesome-er coffee machine, I can get rid of my old one or replace it with a new one. But we don't get rid of old Zoom and replace it with new Zoom. We don't get rid of old Spotify and replace it with new Spotify, old Amazon Prime, or old Jira, or any of those things. Tech products, software products, continuously improve themselves in place. There's no new version of Microsoft Office, or rather, I don't have to go out and buy one in a box and install it over the old one. It will automatically update. Tech products don't improve by, we don't always build new products. We're constantly adding new features and capabilities. Now, these are the things in software development that we start referring to as our requirements. And look, if you work for a company that builds anything, and I suspect most of you do, people are going to ask you how long it takes to turn those features, capabilities, all those requirements into software. So we worry about time. We worry about cost. Cost for software is usually measured in people or how many people over time. And you know that all this stuff is called scope. And if you've been involved in any of this stuff for any length of time, you know about this time, cost, and scope triangle. You all know that this is the bad news triangle, that there's no good news here. We want to know what we can get, how long it's going to take, and what it's going to cost us. The first piece of bad news is you can only know two, meaning you fix time and cost, and the bad news is scope goes down. You fix time and scope, the bad news is cost goes up, and you insist on fixing time, cost, and scope, and the bad news is there's a fourth one, and that is quality. And fixed time, cost, and scope, and quality squeezes out like toothpaste in a toothpaste tube. But none of this actually matters. What matters is this stuff. What matters ultimately is what your customers and users, it's what they do, what they say, and how they feel. Look, I rigged this by asking you what you would say about how you feel, so I know that was what was going to come out. If we build a new feature or capability and we release it, what we hope is that people will see it and try it. We hope that they will use it. We hope that they keep using it. And we hope that they say good things. Somewhere along here, we hope that they pay for it too. Or if our company makes money based upon them using our product, like a Facebook or an Instagram, if we're making money on views or advertising revenue, we hope that they keep using it so we can keep making money. If we release a new feature and a customer sees it, tries it, uses it, and says good things, that's nice. But products are leveraged investments. We need lots of people to do this stuff. When lots of people see it, try it, use it, keep using it, and say good things, that's when you feel it inside your organization. That's supposed to be a building. If this is your org has a different responsibility than your customers, your organization has a responsibility to sustain itself. And it does not sustain itself with happy people. It doesn't pay your paychecks with happy people. It pays your paychecks with money. If lots of people see, try, use, keep using, and along the way pay for this, that's when we see return on investment, or that's when we see profit. If we build something for internal use, we've got an advantage. We don't have to worry about if people use it or keep using it, because they have to. It's their jobs. We're going to fire them if they don't. But we cannot force them to say good things. But the doing we look at for things we build for internal use are things like efficiency and effectiveness. Do they get more work done faster? Do they do better work? Do they make fewer errors? Those are the things we look at. If they do better work and make fewer errors, that saves us cash, and that's where the ROI comes from there. If lots of people say good things, this helps our brand and brand sentiment. If lots of people tell other people and we can sell our product easier, this helps our position in the market, our market share, percentage of the market that we've got. Now, look, I want to point out that in your organization, everybody worries about how long it takes us to build things, and everybody worries about the stuff we get, the return on investment. But when we talk about product thinking, what matters is this stuff in between, this stuff that glues it together. The trick here is we don't get what we want unless they get what they want. When we build products, products are leveraged investments and products are a value exchange. We build something, we spend money building something, and our customers turn that money into more money, and that's what we need. We pay close attention to what happens in here. And well, that's phase one, phase two, and phase three. That's how this works. And this is the part that gets ignored. This is the part that if you've got product managers, they should be paying attention to. Now, if I work backwards from this, those ideas don't come from thin air. They come from customers and users also. They come from recognizing their problems or unmet needs. Instagram, games don't solve problems. Arguably, they create problems. But we are all wired with needs like being entertained and being social and communicating with others. If we can find and exploit those needs, that's where the ideas come from. And all the way back in your organization, must sustain itself. But if you're like most organizations, sustaining itself isn't enough. They're obligated to grow. If your company publishes quarter over quarter financial projections, I can guarantee they don't show your company shrinking over time. That's not popular. The people inside your organization responsible for that, we call those people business stakeholders. And hopefully, they have some sort of vision for where we want to be years from now, some strategy for how they're getting there. And if your organization isn't sustaining itself, isn't growing, isn't moving toward its vision, its strategy isn't working, this creates a business problem. Now, I want you to be clear that business problems are not users' problems. Business problems aren't customers' problems. Your customers and users are not laying awake at night worrying about your quarterly financial targets. That's your problem. Now, here's the other quirk is businesses cannot solve their own problems. If a business wants to grow or wants to even sustain itself, it must then find a customer problem to solve and then build something and wait for customers to turn what they've built back into more money so that they can grow. Product thinking is the focus on this green stuff. You're all experts on product thinking now. Congratulations. Now, look, I draw this model over and over because I want people to recognize the different parts. It's everything between that idea and delivery, that is called output. That's what we build. And building it faster and building it more efficiently, that helps. But what matters is what happens when things come out. The term for that is outcome because of that. And outcome is not measured in what you built or how fast you built it. Outcome is measured in what your customers and users do. Now, some people use the word outcome for everything out here, but I want to draw a distinction between what your customers do and the benefit your organization gets. I'm going to use the word impact for that. Look, it's outcome that drives impact. The other word for both of these things is value. I want you to separate customer and user value from business value, and those things get conflated all the time. The word for these, we'll usually call these opportunities, and I'll stick with business problems or business needs over here. This is the basic language you've got to understand. When we talk about moving from a project to a product-centric posture, the scope of project management is right here in the middle. A successful project is one that finishes on time and delivers what it was supposed to. But when we talk about the scope of product thinking, that is end-to-end. So when Mick Kirsten talks about moving from project to product, this is the scope we're talking about. Now, let me translate this into stuff that, let me turn this into something that matters from a DevOps perspective. Actually, there's one more thing to add to this. The nasty problem with this model is this stupid idea thing. There are three big problems with ideas. The first one is that there are always too many. You know, does anybody work inside of an organization that runs out of ideas or runs out of things to build? Anybody have an empty backlog? Just checking, good, I wanted to hear the nervous laughter. Look, if you talk to any customer user, they've got ideas on how your product could be better. You talk to any business stakeholders, they've got ideas. If you're responsible for product, you may have ideas. The result of this is all those ideas put a lot of back pressure on this, and it just makes it feel like your job is to build more stuff faster. Except for the second problem with ideas, and that is that most of these ideas suck or will not work out. Now, we know this. If I had an idea for a new tech product, I say, hey, I've got this awesome idea for a new tech product. You should all quit your jobs and come and work for me or come and work with me. Anybody know the failure rate of tech startups, out of curiosity?
90%.
90? Yeah, you guys are all dead on. I've got some figures here. The Startup Genome Report has been publishing data for a decade plus. I think I first saw them present something over a decade ago at South by Southwest. I just last week pulled this most recent quote that while 90% of startups completely fail, startup genome research demonstrates that only 1.5% of startups, or about 15% of those that survive, produce a successful exit. That second quote from Harvard Business Review, our HBR article and a Wall Street Journal article, 75% of venture-backed companies never return cash to investors. We know this. If your company, even to get venture capital, you've got to build something and demonstrate a little bit of product market fit or demonstrate the fact that you could make money. But venture capitalists know that 3/4 of the people they give money to, they'll never see a dime in return. Now, look, so basically, if I had an idea for a new product, the odds of me being able to build a product that actually solves a problem that we can actually build, that people will actually see, try, use, and enough of them will to sustain a company are pretty slim. Now, a weird thing happens when we get a product that is sustaining a company. Suddenly, everybody believes their ideas are awesome from now on. And look, I'm going to give a couple things here. If you were to read a book on product management, if you read only one, read a book from this guy. His name is Marty Kagan. Kagan has a long history in this stuff. He started his career as an engineer at Hewlett-Packard. He went from HP to work for Ben Horowitz and Mark Andreessen, if anybody knows who Horowitz and Andreessen are, as a VC fund. But back when he went to work for them, they were responsible, they were in charge of Netscape. Now, when browsers became part of operating systems, Marty left there and went to work for a little company called eBay. It was little when he went there. There were 4 teams at eBay, and he went there to run product management and user experience and was there long enough to see it be a global company. So late 2000s, before 2010. Now, I've known the guy for a long time, and I was talking with him, and we were driving someplace one time, and he nonchalantly said to me, Jeff, if you're really good at this stuff, you will be right about 1/3 of the time. Now, I inverted the number in my head and said, are you kidding me that if I'm really good at this stuff, I'm going to be wrong 2/3 of the time? And he said, well, yeah, but only if you're really good. Most people aren't that good. Now, the quote he would give me to put in this slide is this one, that 50 to 80% of all the software we ship fails to accomplish its objectives. Now, what he means by that is not that things suck or they're terrible or they break in production. It means that no people see them and don't want to try them, or they try them and don't want to use or keep using them, and they definitely don't say good things about them. That's a product failure. It's not a production failure. That's what he's talking about. Now, I did look for current numbers last week. Anybody familiar with the product Pendo? Does anybody work for a company using Pendo as a tool? Pendo gathers analytics. And again, we're pulling analytics not on whether your system is up or whether it's working right, but whether people are actually using the features you're putting in the product. By now, you might have read this quote that based on an aggregation of anonymized product usage data, Pendo determined that 80% of features in the average software product are rarely or never used. That means if you're shipping tons and tons of features and not paying attention to usage, most of what you're shipping does not get used. Look, it's if they don't get what they want, you don't, your company doesn't get what it wants. This is what we focus on. One of the things I ask teams to do when I first walk into an organization is tell me about a few things that you've used. Tell me about a few things you've delivered. I'll ask them to put them on a continuum for me based upon, well, actual effort. The time it took to from when we started working on this until we actually shipped that feature. Did it take days? Or did it take weeks? Or did it take a month or months? Or did it take quarters? Because we know we might, look, we might deploy many times a day, but to build a whole feature in a product, to release a new feature, at minimum may take days. Often takes weeks, and I work with a lot of organizations where months and even quarters are common. I want people to see, look, once we actually ship something, it's at the time that we actually ship it, we know how long it actually took. Now, I don't mean those little stories that went through your last sprint or tiny little backlog items. I mean the whole finished feature. Now, the next thing I want people to do is tell me what the actual outcome is. Now, everything you finish, or right after you ship it, it's in the I don't know category. Because we don't know what the outcome is until people see it, try it, use it, and keep using it. That's it. That's the way it works. Stakeholder satisfaction is not an outcome. Your company does not make money when stakeholders are happy. That's not your business model. Now, once we get some evidence that people are using it, I'll put a continuum here, and I'll ask you guys to do this. You should do this, where at the top is awesome, and at the bottom is awful, and in the middle is a big meh zone. And what we'll usually find, and I've done this tons of times, is that at most third are in this top area. I want to draw that quickly. If you want your company to start to behave in a little bit more product-centric way, actually stop and ask, it'll get used. When I ask companies to do this, one of the first things they start to realize is, we have no idea. We don't have usage data. We've got a lot of metrics on whether our systems are up and how fast we shipped, but we have no metrics on whether people are actually using our product. Or they all start to find out that while we can ship many times a day, it takes users a long time to actually discover and use our product. In fact, if you work for Atlassian on the Jira team, they've learned that for people to use a feature in Jira and be able to detect if they keep using it takes 2 or 3 sprints, so about 6 weeks, something like that. So you can't measure this stuff right away. Outcomes take a lot longer to measure. Now, let's see if I can put some of this stuff together and give you some implications. Look, I want to talk about when we're building what we really build. If you are building or releasing something many times a day, what are the kinds of things we release? I'm in a stumbly part on how I want to transition here, so bear with me a second. If you've got an idea for something to ship, there's a stack of questions I ask people. This is the stack of questions. We want to make sure, we want to be confident our idea is good. The first question we ask is, are we solving a real problem? And what I set product people and teams to work to do is to make sure we're solving a real problem. Now, if you want to find out if you're solving a real problem, or what's the fastest way to learn or get evidence that you're solving a problem, well, if you've got data or metrics that show it, that's great, but what we're looking for is usage metrics here, evidence that people are stumbling or not using your product. But the fastest way to see for solving a real problem is just to talk to people. I'm going to show and tell just a little bit here, because I want to these people are talking to people. These people are with Kodak, and yes, they are still in business. The guy on the right is a product manager for a kiosk there in a CVS store where you would bring in your phone or your camera or a USB stick and print out a high quality picture. The guy on the right is the product manager for that kiosk. The guy on the left is a designer, user experience person. The guy behind the guy on the right is an engineer. You've probably figured out the short white-haired person is not on their team. She's been trying to get a picture out for the last hour. They're doing what's called an intercept interview. They're watching people use their product. Now, I've got lots of pictures of people at work doing this, sitting with people desk side. This guy is in a bank. The guy on the right is a product manager for a line of portable printers. Guy on the left is from China. He designs portable printers. The guy in the middle takes pictures of you and your family in front of the Gateway Monument in Mumbai for 30 rupees. He is a street photographer. Now, that printer does not look very portable to me, but when the guy on the left goes back to China to design, and he's got durability requirements and heat resistance requirements and portability requirements, those things mean something different to him now that he actually understands people's problems. Look, I've got lots of people, but this one says don't wait for permission. I don't have other people in there because this guy is a stock portfolio manager we were told never to talk to because he is far too busy. We showed up in the back of the room and tried to be quiet, and they quickly asked what we were doing there and then quickly asked us to sit down and wanted to show us the problems. We work hard to understand problems. I'll stop that. We were at Starbucks because the company we were working with, it was a pain in the butt for people to park at their company and sign in at security and be led up to a conference room. It was just a lot easier to meet people at Starbucks across the street. I'm going to show another example from this guy, but this guy's name is Sharif. Sharif is somebody I've known for 10 plus years. He is a product manager at Atlassian. How many people use Atlassian tools, Jira or Confluence, things like that? They've got dominant market share. They're strong. If you were an engineer at Atlassian, you're expected to sit in on these customer interviews. That's the way it works. The teams are involved with understanding this stuff. Teams are product teams. They're responsible for the success of the product. By now you've read that quote, that I don't do customer interviews without having a developer in the room. Now, look, the next question we end up having to answer is, when we got an idea, do people actually want this solution? So, there's a way we answer this. One of the easiest ways is to interview and show an example and observe how they react. But let me tell you one of the ways that we use good tech practice to do that. Or actually, let me first show the way that we did this, the old way we did this. This guy's name is Steve Coffer. He's the founder of TripAdvisor. People have heard of that. And he's the one that first started doing this, and he coined the term 404 test.
Web-based, consumer-facing web-based business, there's nothing like running a little test on the website itself to say what do your visitors really want. And the notion of doing a quick test solves umpteen meetings worth of powerful debate and logical arguments. So at TripAdvisor, we've for quite some time done these things called 404 tests, and HTTP 404 error, it's a link, it's broken, it gives you an error. And I'm a fan of, look, you want to test whether consumers want to sign up for a weekly newsletter on ski vacations? Hey, go put a link, before you build the darn thing, go put a link on your ski pages that says, sign up for our ski newsletter.
So it's a 404 test because you literally just redirect your 404s to this?
No, you put the link, you market it any which way you want on the site, the most compelling call to action, sign up, great ski newsletter. But before you actually spend the energy to design and build the product that you're actually going to deliver, in this case a newsletter, you put it on the site for an hour or a day and you see how many people click it. It goes nowhere. It says broken link to the user.
I see.
Your log file says how many people clicked on it.
Yeah.
And, you know, the marketing pushback I got when it was first introduced is, how can you do that to your customers? You're putting a broken link on your site deliberately. And I'm like, look, almost all the visitors' site, when they find a broken link, they're going to blame their internet connection, not me. And what's the worst that can happen? 1,000 people or 5,000 people can hit that broken link, and you're pissed off as a marketeer because we've disappointed 1,000 people. I'm high-fiving it all over the place because with a 10-minute test, I found some great usability, some great user feedback that says they want this feature.
Or yeah, and you've maybe avoided disappointing far more people, right?
Obviously, in the other direction, if nobody actually clicked on it, then all the debate about whether it's a great idea or not is out the window. We couldn't market it on our own site.
Yeah,
if we can't do that, I'm not interested as a feature.
Now, this is the way you answer the do people want this idea or solution without the cooperation of engineers or engineering. We don't do that anymore, although TripAdvisor did do a lot of that. I got a hold of my friend Sharif. He's got longer hair now from the other picture I showed you. Talked with him last week. The current product he's getting launched is something called Atlas. Has anybody heard of Atlassian's Atlas before? Atlas is, there's the, oh, if you have a situation where you don't want your manager to look at Jira, that's what Atlas is for. The Atlas is because you don't want, friends don't let managers look at Jira or something like that. There's a something like that. So now, he's been there a long time, and he's just getting this product release, and they don't call these 404 tests. These get referred to as a fake door test, or a button to nowhere, or a feature fake, and this is super common. In fact, he said, look, we went live with Atlas, and there's a couple dozen feature fakes in the product. And I said, you're kidding, and he said, no, show me one. And he pulled up the screen, and there was a menu choice there, and I've got to zoom in here. It says, look, I want to look at a dependency chart, or look, we've got teams that are dependent on each other. We've got a big project. We want to know what teams are dependent on who. There was a thing there to print a chart, and then once you click that menu choice to put the chart, it shows you an example chart, and it explains what it is, and explains we don't have one. And there's a nice little link there that says, look, if you'd like to learn more, get information from us, this just goes to a Google form where they explain to you what they're imagining, and then they collect a little bit more data from you, and they use that to get a hold of people to talk more about the feature. Now, from this, they get to measure how many people saw the menu choice, how many people clicked on the menu choice, and of the people who clicked on the menu choice, how many people interacted with it, and how many people actually clicked and wanted to talk to them. This gives them evidence. This is super common with a lot of the larger companies that I work with. They feature fake all the time. But they don't feature fake for everyone. They are able to deploy this kind of change very precisely to specific geographic areas, specific kinds of users, users that are more likely to use a specific screen or a specific feature. They're using Launch Darkly to control some of these things. They're using feature toggles to control some of these things. But they're at Atlassian, they've got a lot of precision about who they release to, and they have a lot of data on what they get. So when they've got a lot of data on who interacts with it, a lot of usage data. So when we talk about good DevOps, we talk about releasing many times a day. A lot of the releases are what I refer to as a release to learn, not a release to earn. Our job with this release isn't to make money, isn't to get return on investment, it's to reduce risk. It's to make sure we're building something people want. It's these, do people want our solution? That's where we put these feature fakes. The next question in the stack I ask people is, can we build it predictably? The way you answer that isn't by deploying anything, it's actually to estimate how long it's going to take to build, or we might do some technical research, or what in common agile practice is called a spike. It could be a technical prototype. That may not be something that's released, or may or may not be something that's released, or could be released dark. Now, things like, can they easily learn how to use it? What's interesting is I don't want to release anything for this. I want to build a prototype, and I want to do a usability test. And I want to build just enough that people can use it, and I'm not going to show an example of that, because I want to get to this thing. This last question, will people keep using it? Will people really use this product and get value? Again, I'm going through this stack. When they see it, will they want to try it? Can they learn to use it? Will they keep using it and say good things and really get value? Now, the way we do this is, I'm going to call this is what we refer to more commonly as a release to learn. That's my timer. I think that timer's telling me I'm done. I'm going to show this, and I'm going to do a little bit of summing up here. Look, I'm going to play a little bit of a short video. Some of you have probably seen these Spotify engineering culture videos. This is the second one of those. They're going to, Henrik Niebergen is going to step through a little bit of the kinds of things that they do to test an idea, and then he's going to talk about releasing an MVP. I want you guys to listen closely to who it releases to and what's missing.
Our product development approach is based on lean startup principles and is summarized by the mantra, think it, build it, ship it, tweak it. The biggest risk is always building the wrong thing. So before deciding to build a new product or major feature, we try to inform ourselves with research. Do people actually want this? Does it solve a real problem for them? Then we define a narrative, kind of like a press release or an elevator pitch, showing off the benefits. For example, radio you can save or follow your favorite artist. We also define hypotheses. How will this feature impact user behavior and our core metrics? Will they share more music? Will they log in more often? And we build various prototypes and have people try them out to get a sense of what the feature might feel like and how people react. Once we feel confident this thing is worth building, we go ahead and build an MVP, minimum viable product. Just enough to fulfill the narrative, but far from feature complete. You might call it the minimum lovable product. The next stage of learning happens once we put something into production, so we want to get there as quickly as possible. We release the MVP to just a few percent of all users, and use techniques like A/B testing to measure the impact and test our hypotheses. The squad monitors the data and continues tweaking and redeploying until they see the desired impact. Then they gradually roll out to the rest of the world, while taking the time needed to sort out practical stuff like operational issues and scaling. By the time the product or feature is fully rolled out, we already know it's a success, because if it isn't, we don't roll it out. Impact is always more important than velocity.
So, I wanted you to hear that, look, when they release to learn, it's going to a few percentage of users. In Spotify, that's a few thousand people. It's not a few million people. This is common in a B2C organization. In a B2B organization, what we usually do is choose early adopters. Now, that could be hundreds of people, but it is not hundreds of thousands of people. It is a small fraction. When we look at what's missing, it's just enough to fulfill the narrative, but far from feature complete. So functionality is missing. We're shipping this to early adopters. It is just enough to let people use it and start to like the feature. What's also missing is scale and performance. For the people who do this, they know, I'm shipping to a few thousand, I'm shipping to a few hundred, I'm not shipping to millions. I don't need to localize it for different locations. I may not need to add a lot of monitoring because it's not in production. In fact, go-to-market or operational support, that's also something that's missing. This type of release is much smaller, and it's, well, once again, it's a release to learn. It's not going to make you money. These releases are much smaller. What I expect to see at a company like Spotify or Atlassian are dozens of releases to learn, followed by a release to earn, after we're confident that we're going to get the desired impact. The mantra for people who do this work is to nail it before you scale it. The mistake I see most organizations do is scale it before they nail it. Or some of you have probably seen the weird variation where we nail it and forget to scale it, where you release it to a few people and somebody says, turn it on for everybody, and it falls over because it doesn't perform and it's missing things it needs for everybody else. Look, what I want you to see is we use DevOps in production to fake features. We use engineering to test our ideas or build code. We release to learn iteratively. And when you see companies like Spotify, companies like Amazon saying how frequently they release, for companies like that, a large portion of those releases are releases to learn. And in organizations that I see new to DevOps, they don't have that capability to narrowly target their releases to specific people, to monitor usage metrics to know if they're actually working or not working, and to keep track of how many releases to learn it took to be able to get to a release to earn. Now, I started a little bit late, and I kind of want to sum some things up here. I might have talked a little bit more about metrics, but yeah, I had too much to put in here. Look, I worry about those DORA metrics sometime. If you can measure your cycle time and deployment frequency, but you cannot measure if what you ship is actually used, that's a problem. And when I've been to a lot of DevOps conferences and other things like that, and I'm surprised at how much data we have. Is anybody here in the room from New Relic? I don't want to make sure there's, I remember talking with product people at New Relic, and the shock for me is they have tons of data on how products are operating, but they have no data on whether people are actually using their product. This was years ago. So it's an interesting shock to me sometimes. Look, if I had real prod DevOps metrics, equivalent to those DORA metrics, I would want to know learning velocity. I definitely want usage metrics for everything we release, and I want to know what key usage metrics are and what we're releasing. And I want to know the ratio of releases to learn to releases to earn. Releases that are targeted at narrow audiences with the intent of learning in relation to the releases that are targeted for everybody. I want to know delivery velocity, like that ratio of dark releases. I haven't talked much about that. I see a lot of people kind of gaming DORA metrics by releasing many times a day, but releasing dark. So it's not even to learn or earn. I want to see that ratio. And I want to see the cycle time from first release to learn. How long does it take, not from idea to release, but from when we first start trying to release something to learn until we actually start making money? If I sum this up, that look, good prod DevOps practice focuses on fast learning, learning about our product, that effective product leaders leverage DevOps to build to learn. I spend a lot of time talking with the DevOps people about what they've got to do, and a lot of time talking to product people on how they've got to leverage what they're doing. And I want people to distinguish when we're releasing to learn versus releasing to earn, and get the hang of nailing it before you scale it. That's it. All right, I'm going to stop there. Helpful? Yeah. All right, thank you very much. Oh, I didn't say three. Oh my God, that was the punchline to the joke. Here's the third. Has anybody ever visited a startup accelerator? I thought there was one here in this building. Visited a startup accelerator or incubator before? There's co-working spaces where lots of startups work under one roof. Now, the surprising thing to me is when you walk into there, everybody seems really happy and really positive, despite the fact that 90% of them are going to be looking for jobs this time next year. Now, if I told you that 90% of your employees are going to be laid off throughout the year, your company would be very depressing. Now, startup founders are not stupid. They know the failure rates of startups. You can ask any one of them what the failure rates of startups are, and they say, well, it's 90%. And you can ask them about any other company in the room, and they can easily say most of their ideas suck, but not ours. This is called bias. I forgot to make this point, and that's why we do any of this paying to learn. That's why we do this, because we are blessed or cursed with some stupid-ass bias that makes us believe that we are always right. That's why. Okay, thank you. That joke ties everything together.